Hi everyone! Welcome back to IntegralCalc.com. Today we're going to be doing another second order non-homogeneous differential equations problem. And in this particular problem we've been given the equation y double prime plus 4y prime prime plus 4y equals 130 cosine of 3x. So whenever you're dealing with second order differential equations, the thing that you need to first know is that it's a homogeneous differential equation if the right-hand side here is equal to zero, if you have zero on the right-hand side. If it's anything other than zero, it's a non-homogeneous equation. So in our particular case, obviously, we're dealing with a non-homogeneous differential equation. We're going to solve this in two steps, really. The first one being we're going to find a general solution to the left-hand side, and then we're going to go ahead and find a particular solution based on the right-hand side. So we're going to go ahead first and ignore the right-hand side completely, basically pretend that the left-hand side is equal to zero, essentially that it's a homogeneous equation, and we're going to find solutions for the right-hand side. So the way that we're going to do that is first to convert these y double prime, y prime, and y into our variables. And the way I like to do that is just a trick that I think is easy. I count the number of hash marks here on this y variable. I see that there's two hash marks, so I'm going to change that into r squared. Here I see that I've got one hash mark on the y, so I'm changing that into r to the first power, which of course is just r. And then I see I have zero hash marks here on this y variable, so I'm going to call that r to the zero. Anything raised to the zero power is just one. So this y variable here is just going to become 1, and I'm going to end up with 4 times 1, which is just 4. And basically, I'm going to set that equal to 0 instead of what I actually have over here on the right-hand side. And now I want to solve for r. When I factor this, I'll get r plus 2 times r plus 2 equals 0. So I see that I have two real roots, but they are equal real roots. So I have two solutions. One is negative 2, and the other is also negative 2. So I have, in this case, equal real roots, meaning these are both real numbers, but they're equal to one another, as opposed to distinct real roots. When you have equal real roots, the formula that you use for the general solution of the differential equation is this one here for y of x. And we take our two roots, negative 2 and negative 2, and we plug them in for r sub 1 and r sub 2, which in this case are equal to one another. So I'm going to go ahead and say that for the general solution, y of x is equal to c sub 1 e to the negative 2x plus c sub 2 times x e to the negative 2x. This x here is what distinguishes the first term from the second term, otherwise they would be exactly equal to one another. So this is going to be our general solution. And now, and this was based on just the left-hand side alone of our original equation. Now, based on the right-hand side of the original equation, we need to go ahead and find a particular solution. And the way we're going to do it is using the method of undetermined coefficients. And basically what that means is that we're going to make a guess about the format of the right-hand side of our equation. So we're going to look at the format over here of this, 130 times cosine of 3x. We're going to make a guess about the general format of that for the particular solution, and then we're going to derive that that guess for the particular solution and plug it back into the left-hand side to see if we can get coefficients to match on both sides of the equation. So it sounds a little confusing now, but it's not as bad as you might think. So just a couple tricks. You'll want to look for constants, first of all, like this 130, and I don't mean constants that stand alone, but just the number here, 130, right? And we want to substitute variables for those. The only time we don't want to substitute a variable is if we have a number like this 3 here inside a trigonometric identity. So because this is 3, which is part of 3x, inside the cosine function, we want to ignore it. We would also want to ignore a constant if it was inside the exponent on the number e. So for example, if you had e to the 2x, you wouldn't want to replace that 2 with a variable. But we do want to go ahead and replace the 130 with a variable. So our guess first for the particular solution, which we'll denote as y sub p, is going to be a times cosine of 3x. We want to go ahead and leave that 3x alone. And whenever you have a trigonometric identity on the right-hand side, either cosine or sine, it's quite likely that you'll have to add in another trigonometric identity. So when you have cosine, for example, on the right-hand side, you almost always want to add sine of the same thing. So we're going to add sine of 3x, and we want to go ahead and put a different variable, b, out in front of sine of 3x. If we didn't add that sine of 3x, we're going to end up with a sine of 3x on the left-hand side and no sine of 3x on the right-hand side to equate it to. So we want to go ahead and add that in there, and that's going to be our guess for the particular solution. Now what we want to do is go ahead and find the first and second derivative of the particular solution. We'll plug the second derivative in for y double prime and the first derivative in for y prime. This particular solution here that we just found, y sub p, we're going to be plugging in for y up here in our original equation. So we're going to find the derivative y prime of p, and when we take the derivative of y of p, remember that we're going to be treating a and b as constants. So when we find the derivative of y of p, we're going to get the derivative of cosine, which is negative sine. We have to, of course, multiply by the derivative of the inside function 3x. So we'll end up with actually negative 3a sine of 3x. Sine of 3x. And then for b sine of 3x, the derivative of sine is cosine. We have to multiply by the inside, or the derivative of the inside. So we'll get plus 3b cosine of 3x. So that's our first derivative. Then we want to go ahead and take our second derivative, y double prime of p. And again, the derivative of sine here, sine of 3x, is cosine of 3x, and we have to multiply by the derivative of the inside. The inside is 3x, and the derivative of that is 3, so we're going to multiply by 3, so we get negative 9a cosine of 3x. And then for 3b cosine of 3x, again, we'll want to multiply by 3, and the derivative of cosine is negative sine, so we're going to end up with a negative, so we're going to get minus 9b sine of 3x. So that is our second derivative. Now we want to go ahead and plug these into our original equation. On the left-hand side, we're going to leave the right-hand side exactly as it is. So we'll take the second derivative and plug that in first. We'll get negative 9a cosine of 3x minus 9b sine of 3x. And then we'll get plus, we'll multiply 4 up here, multiply 4 by the first derivative. So when we get, and let me actually subtract here. So we've got, this is our second derivative here. So we're going to be multiplying this guy by 4 based on this coefficient up here. So we'll end up with negative 12a sine of 3x plus 12b cosine of 3x. And then we have to multiply the particular solution here by 4 as well, based on this coefficient up here of 4. So we'll get plus 4a cosine of 3x plus 4b cosine, plus 4b times sine of 3x. And we're going to set that equal to the right-hand side, 130 cosine of 3x. So now we want to simplify the right-hand side as much as we can. So if we add up all of our cosines and all of our sines separately from one another, for cosine, and again, we'll take the coefficients on the cosine function. So we have negative 9a here on the first cosine function. So negative 9a, we're looking for another cosine, plus 12b on this cosine function, plus 4a on that third cosine function there, is all the cosines. So times cosine of 3x. Then we're going to be looking at the coefficients on the sine function. So you'll notice the first one is negative 9b here for sine, minus 12a in front of the sine function, plus 4b in front of this last sine function. That's all going to be times sine of 3x, and that'll be equal to 130 cosine of 3x. So now we're going to use the method of undetermined coefficients to set coefficients on the right and left-hand sides equal to one another. So we have a coefficient of negative 9a plus 12b plus 4a in front of the cosine function on the left-hand side. That's the same here as 130, which is in front of cosine on the right-hand side. So we're going to set those two equal to one another. So we'll say negative 9a plus 12b plus 4a is equal to 130. And then we also know that negative 9b minus 12a plus 4b over here on the right-hand side is equal to 0 because there is no sine of 3x over here on the right-hand side. So the coefficient in front of that is 0. So we know that negative 9b minus 12a plus 4b is equal to 0. So now we're going to use simultaneous equations to solve these two equations for a and b. So first we need to go ahead and simplify them because we can do a little bit of that. So when we do that, negative 9a plus 4a in the first equation is going to give us negative 5a plus 12b equals 130. And then in the second equation here, we've got negative 12a. Negative 9b plus 4b is negative 5b, which is equal to 0. So now we can multiply these two equations. We'll multiply the top one. Let's say we'll multiply this bottom one here by 12, and we'll multiply the top one here by 5, and what that's going to do is give us 60b for both of these, so we'll be able to add the equations together and cancel out the b so we can solve for a and then plug back in to get b. So when we multiply the top equation by 5, we'll get negative 25a plus 60b equals 5 times 130 is 650. And then the bottom equation we're multiplying by 12, so we'll get negative 144a minus 60b equals 0. So now we can add these two equations together. So we're going to take the whole second equation and we're going to add it to the first equation, because when we add positive 60b and negative 60b, those two will cancel. So when we add negative 25a to negative 144a, we'll get negative 169a, and that's going to be equal to 650, which is obviously 650 plus 0. So when we divide 650 by negative 169, we find that a is actually equal to negative 50 over 13. We can divide both of those by 13. We get negative 50 over 13. So that is our answer there for A. Now we need to go ahead and plug A back into one of these equations so we can solve for B. So we'll plug it back into the first one up here, and we'll get negative 5 times negative 50 over 13 plus 12B equals 130. When we multiply this out over here on the right hand side, we'll get 250 over 13 plus 12b equals 130. Then if we multiply through by 13 to get rid of the fraction, we'll get 250 plus 12 times 13 is 156. So 156b, and then 130 times 13 is 16b.
90. We'll subtract 250 from both sides and get 156b equals 1690 minus 250 is 1440. And then divide both sides by 156, and we'll simplify that fraction, and we'll find that b is equal to 120 over 13. So that's our answer for b. So we use the method of undetermined coefficients to find a and b, and now we need to plug a and b back into our particular solution, the guess that we made for the particular solution. So I can go ahead and erase all this stuff because we won't need it anymore. So when we plug a and b back into our particular solution here, y of p, we'll find that we get negative 50 over 13 for a. So negative 50 over 13 times cosine of 3x plus, and then we got 120 over 13 for b. So we plug that in for b, and we get sine of 3x. So that would be the particular solution, but what we really want is this particular solution that we found here for the right-hand side added to what we found earlier for the general solution. So we want to add this to our general solution. So your final answer is actually going to be y of x equals, and you always want to write the part that represents the general solution first. So c sub 1 e to the negative 2x plus c sub 2 x e to the negative 2x. And then you add the particular solution that we found. So minus 50 over 13 cosine of 3x plus 120 over 13 sine of 3x. And this now, since you've added them together, is your final answer for the particular solution of this second order non-homogeneous differential equation. So that's it. I hope this video helped you guys, and I'll see you in the next one.